our summer expedition programs taking us across the northern states of India.
We're in Varanasi, one of the more sacred and important places for followers of Hinduism, the main religion here in India.
Here's what's coming up today.
The ceremony is performed along the banks of the river every day.
I get spruced up for a meeting with Rajasthani royalty.
And I get kitted out for our journey across the region. The river we're travelling down is called the Ganges, and it is a vital lifeline for the people of Varanasi.
As you drift past the steps, or ghats as they're known, people are bathing, washing their clothes, cooling off, or just having a little swim. But for the large Hindu population here, the River Ganges is also regarded as the holiest waterway in India.
It's said the Ganges was created to transport the souls of the dead into heaven. Hindus come here from all over the world to give thanks to Mai Ganga, or Mother Ganges.
Good skills, thanks very much.
Hinduism originated in India 3,000 years ago, and 80% of the population are Hindu.
See you in a bit. Have a nice time. All right.
Behind the ghats and waterways of Varanasi lie ornate temples where Hindus come to pray every day, ringing bells as they enter as a calling to God. Simon and I were marked with a red spot or a ticker and given garlands of flowers as a holy blessing.
Hindus believe in one universal soul or god called Brahman. Brahman exists in everything throughout the universe, from the smallest grain of sand to the biggest mountain or sea.
As Hindus believe Brahman is in everything, followers give thanks for all creations, from fire to rivers like the Ganges to animals like the sacred cow.
As Brahman is everywhere and in everything, Hindus don't worship him directly. Instead, they pray to one of the many minor gods or deities who represent different parts of his character.
These gods take on many unusual forms, from the wise elephant-headed Ganesh to the courageous monkey god Hanuman.
There are thousands of deities in the Hindu world, and each has three key parts: the god themselves, their vehicle, and their power.
Of the many deities, one of the most praised is the powerful and mysterious god, Lord Shiva.
Varanasi is said to be the home of Shiva, which is why this city is so sacred.
The story goes that the Ganges sprung from Shiva's head, and today the river is regarded as a god in its own right, called Ganga. Bathing in the waters is said to cleanse the soul, but that doesn't mean that it can't be fun.
We're at the part of the Ganges where all the men are taking baths over there. I'm not allowed to go there because I'm a woman. And here is where they jump off on this sort of platform into the Ganges, and they're very good divers. Gopi is going to demonstrate for us.
Oh, there he goes. Look at that. What do you think? Connie next? Connie?
Me in?
Yes,
no,
why
that's
not?
The boys' bathroom. No. Can you do it?
Yes,
yeah,
why
you
not?
Going to?
Next competitor. Here we go. Ready? Yes.
My name Babu.
Babu, okay, Babu's
Babu. Babu, he's Babu. Oh, he doesn't give up. There he goes.
Whoa.
Oh, and straight away. There he goes, straight in. That's a superb dive.
Please.
He's happy.
Okay, well, I'm now about to wash my feet in the Ganges. The water is sacred. So, in this lovely and cool, actually.
Connie, how does it feel to be sharing your bath with some cows?
Well, I've never had a bath with cows before.
Super, ready, go! Oh, it's a big one. It's a super takeoff, look at that!
Hey! I didn't know bath time could be so much fun.
Lovely stuff. Woo! Hello!
Hello.
Bye.
Goodbye.
The Ganges is divided into different sections or ghats. We had special permission to film at a stretch reserved for the most personal and sacred of ceremonies.
Hindus celebrate death, seeing it not as the end of a life, but as the beginning of the next. They believe in reincarnation or rebirth. If you've been a good person in this life, then your soul will return in another body, and you will lead a more peaceful and better life next time round. As Hindus see the body as just a shell housing the soul, they choose to cremate or burn the bodies of the dead on piles of wood in a simple public ceremony.
Many mourners can't afford the wood sold along the banks of the river and so carry their own wood for hundreds of miles to use in the cremation service.
Another part of the cremation ceremony is that the male members of the family shave their heads to signify a fresh start and new growth. I have to say, coming from a country where death and funerals are still very much a private affair, seeing such public cremations happening just down there is really rather strange. And the other thing that has really grabbed me is the fact there is no expression of emotion. People aren't crying as you would normally see at a funeral. And that's because they believe that will affect the passage of the soul into the afterlife.
And helping the soul on its journey from Varanasi has particular importance to Hindus.
They believe that if your life ends in this holy city, then the cycle of reincarnation stops and your soul will rest in peace for eternity.
For this reason, pilgrims come to Varanasi from all over the world to die in the city and have their ashes spread in the holy river Ganges.
To the people of Varanasi, the Ganges is so important that each night crowds gather along its banks to give praise in a display of music, colour and light.
Quite sure what's going on. The atmosphere is incredible and it's a really happy feeling.
I've been put on bell duty and there is a whole series of bells running along this entire stretch, and the reason they're rung is basically to awaken their god and welcome him into the ceremony.
Amazing. It feels so sort of spiritual, and even though we're not Hindu, you feel like you're totally welcome and you're a whole part of the celebration.
Yeah, but what I can't get over is you feel like it's a one-off special occasion, but it's not. This happens every single night.
It's hard not to be touched by the spirituality of Varanasi and the passion of the people who live and worship here.
That's the last one. Now, sadly, we're going to leave Varanasi behind, but we are going to continue our journey of planes, trains and beeping cars across the very hot region of Rajasthan. Come on, guys, let's go to the airport.
We had a long journey ahead of us, and I wasn't really looking forward to it that much. After 2 weeks in India, I'd finally been hit with my first bout of tummy trouble.
I was literally going every 20 minutes all night long, and I thought, surely I can't go anymore, but...
I haven't had that version.
So what had caused it then, Matt?
Well, various things. We were trying this sweet lime juice, which I think sort of...
Triggered it.
Yeah, triggered it. And that was it then. So I went from there. But I'm not used to sort of eating curry for every meal, which I have been. So
I thought you were in training before we came out here.
Well, I did have a few Papadum crisps before we came out.
It wasn't enough, was it,
Matt? No, it didn't really.
This one's Connie's. There it is. Month's worth of clothes in there.
For the first time on our expedition, we decided to fly to our next destination. Unfortunately, we faced a 2-hour delay, with only my musical talents for entertainment.
Hello. How are you?
I'm fine.
It's a bit warm out there.
3 hours after leaving the centre of Varanasi, we were finally on our way. Our destination was Jaipur, known as the Pink City, as many of its buildings are made from red sandstone. Here, pink is the colour of bravery and courage.
As much of Rajasthan is desert, I'd been told that the most useful item I could pick up in Jaipur was a traditional pair of desert shoes or jutis, but I'd have to make them.
Ah, Om Rakesh. Very nice to see you. Thanks for inviting me. We get going on some nice shoes, I think. Lovely. First job we have is to measure the size of my feet. So, Om Rakesh has got a template here. You happy with that? Okay, so that's what we're going to cut, a size 9.
Om Prakash has been making jutis for over 18 years, so although the template seemed a little large, I was confident of a good fit.
Oh, I see what you're doing, just getting a general shape. It's not really a juti shoe shape as yet, but will be shortly.
Our first task was to shave and soften the sole to make it a bit more comfortable.
Om Prakash, I might just ask you at this point just to finish it off, because I don't see you making an awful lot of headway. You make that look extraordinarily easy.
The tools and techniques for making jutis have changed very little over hundreds of years, but the simple and effective design means they're as popular as ever.
Hello! Bit of an audience today, I tell you what. That's a bit of a turn up for the books, me turning up and having a crack at making a pair of jutis. Oh, I'm really sorry if I'm making a hash of this. Oh dear. Do you want to have a quick mop up the mess? Well, I'll tell you what, by the time I've finished, I'm not going to have a very large shoe. So if I make them too small, I'll have to give them to Connie, because she's got very small feet. Beautifully done. The next stage in the juti making process is making the tops of the shoes, which are called the uppers. They look a little bit like heart-shaped archways, but you'll see exactly why they are this shape in just a short while. They certainly make the shoes very, very individual. Okay, lead the way, Om Prakash. Right, so you're just bending the edge over. Okay, let's give it another go. Now you got me going. Oh, that's exactly what you don't want to do. Just a nice clipper into the thumb, bit of a crack to the nail. You happy with that? That's good. Right.
To make sure the sand of the desert is kept away from your feet, the juti has to be sewn together with thick cord.
This here is what is used to stitch the sole to the upper part of the shoe, and it may look like a rather thick piece of string, but it's actually loads and loads of threads of cotton. And to make it a bit stronger, Om Prakash has wrapped it around my foot, you basically just give it a couple of twists with the hand, like so, and that just tightens it together, and that is now ready for stitching. Let me just show you quickly the needle that is going to be involved. Think of an ordinary sewing needle, and then check this little fellow out. Absolutely massive. So in there, and then you have to pull this really, really tight. I'll tell you what, it takes Om Prakash a day to make a pair. I think if you left me to my own devices, we'd be looking at a good week. Okay, that feels good.
Om Prakash helped me with the remainder of the sole and attached the crucial finishing touches before the final fitting.
Well, as with every new pair of shoes, the real test is in the standing. They're a little bit tight just across the top, but you have to say they certainly are individualistic. The only question now is, with or without socks.
Hi, how are you?
Unfortunately, it was a decision that would have to wait, as we needed to get to our next destination, the city of Jodhpur, by the end of the day.
Well, we're just waiting for the train to turn up. In the meantime, I've had a little bit of a problem with one of our bags. This has got all the sound equipment in, and the zips have come off. But not to worry, because there are skilled tradesmen all over the place, and this lad's just popped up and said, would you like us to fix it? And look what he's got here. Ring full of zips. He's working under pressure as well. Not only has he got a huge crowd behind him, but we're expecting the train in literally 2 minutes.
Like most of India, train travel is incredibly popular in Rajasthan, as it's a cheap and effective way of crossing the hot desert landscape.
Well, while we stand and wait and keep a lookout for the train amongst the halls of people, Liz is just sitting on the bench brushing her teeth. She is strange sometimes, has to be said.
See if she notices. Let's see how long it takes us. Hey!
We faced a long and cramped journey through the night, but at least the train was running on time.
Well, it's just gone 11:30 at night. We've just arrived at Jodhpur, and I've got to get some sleep because I've got a royal appointment in the morning.
Jodhpur, on the edge of the Thar Desert, was founded in 1459 by Rao Jodha, who gave the city its name. Many of Jodhpur's houses are painted blue, which is seen as a holy colour, and therefore it's known as the Blue City.
But it's most famous for inspiring these, the Jodhpurs, worn by the local men and named after the city.
But I had to change out of my Jodhpurs and into something a lot smarter. I'd been honoured to receive an invitation to the magnificent Umaid Bhavan Palace to meet the head of one of India's oldest royal families, Jai Singh, the Maharaja of Jodhpur.
Well, Your Majesty, first of all, what a beautiful place you have.
I'm glad you like it.
It's lovely.
Glad to have you all here.
Thank you very much. Now, there are Maharajas all over India. So traditionally, what is the role of a Maharaja?
Maharajas were local kings. My family established control over this area way back in 1211.
So how old were you when you became a Maharaja?
I was only 4 years old, and I had a ceremony at the fort. It was very awe-inspiring to see all these people in their turbans and moustaches and beards and swords.
Like all Maharajas, Jai Singh enjoys huge wealth and privilege. But when he was a boy, there were certain things even a Maharaja couldn't avoid.
At the age of 8, I was sent to prep school in England.
Right. Well, I'll tell you, there'll be a lot of sort of 8 to 11-year-olds watching this now. So just give them an idea of what it was like for you to effectively have been a king of Jodhpur and then move and leave all of your family and Rajasthan behind.
We used to have cold baths in the morning. Enforced cold bath, you had to have take a dip, except in severe winter. So basically I did kind of dual life, being Indian when I was here and then being an English schoolboy when I was in England.
Well, Your Majesty, thank you so much for talking to us. It has been great to meet you. Thank you.
Although in modern Rajasthan, Maharajas have no real power, the Rajput people were traditionally great warriors, building huge forts to protect their wealth.
Jodhpur is home to one of the largest forts in India, Maranga Fort. It dominates the city, and rather appropriately, Maranga means majestic. It is absolutely huge. The walls are 36 metres high and about 21 metres deep.
When the fort was occupied, it was split in half, the yellow section for men and the red section for women. Although both lived in splendour, the women were kept away from important ceremonies.
If they wanted to know what was going on in the courtyard, they had to peer through lattices like this. They could see what was happening, but the men couldn't see them.
The fort's main purpose was to defend the city, and so it was built high on a hill.
The road to the gates is very steep and full of bends.
This slowed down invading warriors who rode on elephant back, and they would be pelted with stones, arrows, and boiling oil.
If they made it past that, any invader would have to get past seven metal doors covered in razor-sharp spikes. Unsurprisingly, very few made it that far. However, if Rajput warriors were killed in battle, their wives were also made to die.
In a tradition known as sati, grieving widows would mark their hands here and then throw themselves onto huge fires and burn to death. The tradition of sati was only outlawed 60 years ago.
Fortunately, in Rajasthan, the days of warring clans are over, and the Maharaja's forts and palaces are used as hotels and museums.
To end our time in Jodhpur, the Maharaja had invited us to spend the evening at his summer palace. This time, the transport was something rather special.
The Maharaja was very impressed with my outfit. Guys.
Thanks like for inviting us.
Yeah, lovely, right?
It's beautiful. We feel very special.
Feel
like royalty.
It certainly is. And this is where the Maharaja spends his summer months, so we are very honoured to be having dinner here tonight.
But although the setting was perfect, certain dinner guests were not so welcome. Hundreds of giant fruit bats swarming over the lake to pick up their evening meal.
Ravenous.
Really good, isn't it?
Lovely.
Oh, that's delightful.
We are being spoiled rotten.
A beautiful meal and a stunning sunset was just the way to end the first part of our journey east to west across Rajasthan. But this would be our last taste of luxury.
In our next India programme, you can see us venture deep into the Thar Desert, where we go back to basics and meet some of the locals.
Thanks, guys. Now, if you want to enter Blue Peter's competition,